of Mice and Men by John Steinbeck. Born in Salinas, California in 1902, John Steinbeck grew up in one of the most fertile valleys in the state, an area that became the setting for much of his greatest fiction. In the 50 years prior to the publication of Mice and Men, much of the region's wheat and fruit crops were picked by migrant workers who followed the harvests, mostly single men without home or family, with a knapsack and a bedroll as their only possessions. Steinbeck himself had worked the fields and packing plants as a high school student, and after leaving Stanford University, where he only half-heartedly pursued his studies, he joined the ranks of the migrants, moving from ranch to ranch for nearly 2 years, experiencing firsthand the loneliness and isolation of the itinerant working man. In 1935, many years after his laboring days, and more than a dozen after he had begun to scratch out a living as a writer, John Steinbeck published his first major success, Tortilla Flat, at the age of 33. It was quickly followed by In Dubious Battle, a bestseller as well. When Tortilla Flat sold to the movies for the fabulous sum of $4,000, Steinbeck found himself for the first time in a position of financial security. In this newfound state of artistic independence, he began work on a novel that he originally titled Something That Happened. It was published in 1937 as Of Mice and Men. The title is taken from a Robert Burns poem. And now, Of Mice and Men.
A few miles south of Soledad, the Salinas River drops in close to the hillside bank and runs deep and green. The water is warm, too, for it has slipped twinkling over the yellow sands in the sunlight before reaching the narrow pool. On one side of the river, the golden foothill slopes curve up to the strong and rocky Gavilan Mountains, but on the valley side, the water is lined with trees. Willows, fresh and green with every spring, carrying in their lower leaf junctures the debris of the winter's flooding, and sycamores with mottled white recumbent limbs and branches that arch over the pool. On the sandy bank under the trees, the leaves lie deep and so crisp that a lizard makes a great skittering if he runs among them. Rabbits come out of the brush to sit on the sand in the evening, and the damp flats are covered with the night tracks of coons, and with the spread pads of dogs from the ranches, and with the split wedge tracks of deer that come to drink in the dark. There's a path through the willows and among the sycamores, a path beaten hard by boys coming down from the ranches to swim in the deep pool, and beaten hard by tramps who come wearily down from the highway in the evening to jungle up near water. In front of the low horizontal limb of a giant sycamore, there's an ash pile made by many fires. The limb is worn smooth by men who have sat on it. Evening of a hot day started the little wind to moving among the leaves. The shade climbed up the hills toward the top. On the sandbanks, the rabbits sat as quietly as little gray sculptured stones. And then, from the direction of the state highway, came the sound of footsteps on crisp sycamore leaves. The rabbits hurried noiselessly for cover. A stilted heron labored up into the air and pounded downriver. For a moment, the place was lifeless. And then two men emerged from the path and came into the opening by the green pool. They had walked in single file down the path, and even in the open, one stayed behind the other. Both were dressed in denim trousers and in denim coats with brass buttons. Both wore black, shapeless hats, and both carried tight blanket rolls slung over their shoulders. The first man was small and quick, dark of face, with restless eyes and sharp, strong features. Every part of him was defined: small, strong hands, slender arms, a thin and bony nose. Behind him, walked his opposite. A huge man, shapeless of face, with large, pale eyes, with wide, sloping shoulders. And he walked heavily, dragging his feet a little, the way a bear drags his paws. His arms didn't swing at his sides, but hung loosely. The first man stopped short in the clearing, and the follower nearly ran over him. He took off his hat and wiped the sweatband with his forefinger and snapped the moisture off. His huge companion dropped his blankets and flung himself down and drank from the surface of the green pool, drank with long gulps, snorting into the water like a horse. The small man stepped nervously beside him. "Lenny," he said sharply. "Lenny, for God's sake, don't drink so much." Lenny continued to snort into the pool. The small man leaned over and shook him by the shoulder. "Lenny, you're going to be sick like you was last night." Lenny dipped his whole head under, hat and all, and then he sat up on the bank and his hat dripped down on his blue coat and ran down his back. "That's good," he said. "You drink some, George. You take a good big drink." He smiled happily. George unslung his bindle and dropped it gently on the bank. "I ain't sure it's good water," he said. "Looks kind of scummy." Lenny dabbled his big paw in the water and wiggled his fingers so the water arose in little splashes. Rings widened across the pool to the other side and came back again. Lenny watched them go. "Look, George, look what I've done." George knelt beside the pool and drank from his hand with quick scoops. "Tastes all right," he admitted. "Don't really seem to be running, though." "You never ought to drink water when it ain't running, Lenny," he said hopelessly. "You'd drink out of a gutter if you was thirsty." He threw a scoop of water into his face and rubbed it about with his hand under his chin and around the back of his neck. Then he replaced his hat, pushed himself back from the river, drew up his knees, and embraced them. Lenny, who had been watching, imitated George exactly. He pushed himself back, drew up his knees, embraced them, looked over to George to see whether he had it just right. He pulled his hat down a little more over his eyes, the way George's hat was. George stared morosely at the water. The rims of his eyes were red with sun glare. He said angrily, "We could just as well have rode clear to the ranch if that bastard bus driver knew what he was talking about. Just a little stretch down the highway," he says. "Just a little stretch. Goddamn near 4 miles, that's what it was. Didn't want to stop at the ranch gate, that's what. Too goddamn lazy to pull up. Wonder he isn't too damn good to stop in Soledad at all. Kicks us out and says, 'Just a little stretch down the road.' I bet it was more than 4 miles. Damn hot day." Lenny looked timidly over to him. "George?" "Yeah, what do you want?" "Where are we going, George?" The little man jerked down the brim of his hat and scowled over at Lenny. "So you forgot that already, did you? I gotta tell you again, do I? Jesus Christ, you're a crazy bastard." "I forgot," Lenny said softly. "I tried not to forget. Honest to God, I did, George." "Okay, okay. I'll tell you again. I ain't got nothing to do. Might just as well spend all my time telling you things, and then you forget them, and I tell you again." "Tried and tried," said Lenny, "but it didn't do no good. I remember about the rabbits, George. The hell with the rabbits. That's all you ever can remember is them rabbits." "Okay, now you listen, and this time you gotta remember so we don't get in no trouble. You remember sitting in that gutter on Howard Street and watching that blackboard?" Lenny's face broke into a delighted smile. "Why, sure, George, I remember that. But what'd we do then? I remember some girls come by, and you says, you say, to hell with what I says. You remember about us going into Murray and Reddy's, and they give us work cards and bus tickets? Oh, sure, George, I remember that now. His hands went quickly into his side coat pockets. He said gently, George, I ain't got mine. I must have lost it. He looked down at the ground in despair. You never had none, you crazy bastard. I got both of them here. Think I'd let you carry your own work card? Lenny grinned with relief. I thought I put it in my side pocket. His hand went into the pocket again. George looked sharply at him. What'd you take out of that pocket? I ain't a thing in my pocket, Lenny said cleverly. I know there ain't. You got it in your hand. What you got in your hand, hiding it? I ain't got nothing, George. Honest. Come on. Give it here. Lenny held his closed hand away from George's direction. It's only a mouse, George. A mouse? A live mouse? Uh-uh. Just a dead mouse, George. I didn't kill it. Honest, I found it. I found it dead. Give it here, said George. Oh, leave me have it, George. Give it here. Lenny's closed hand slowly obeyed. George took the mouse and threw it across the pool to the other side among the brush. What do you want of a dead mouse, anyways? Why, I could pet it with my thumb while we walked along, said Lenny. Well, you ain't petting no mice while you walk with me. You remember where we're going now? Lenny looked startled, and then in embarrassment hid his face against his knees. I forgot again. Jesus Christ, George said resignedly. Well, look. We're going to work on a ranch like the one we come from up north.
Up north? In Weed.
Oh, sure, I remember. In Weed. That ranch we're going to is right down there, about a quarter mile. We're going to go in and see the boss. Now look, I'll give him the work tickets, but you ain't going to say a word. You just stand there and don't say nothing. If he finds out what a crazy bastard you are, we won't get no job. But if he sees you work before he hears you talk, we're set. You got that?
Sure, George. Sure, I got it.
Okay. Now, when we go in to see the boss, what are you going to do? Lenny thought. His face grew tight with thought. I ain't gonna say nothing, just gonna stand there. Good boy. That's swell. You say that over 2-3 times so you're sure you won't forget it. Lenny droned to himself softly.
I ain't gonna say nothing. I ain't gonna say nothing. I ain't gonna say nothing.
Okay, said George, and you ain't going to do no bad things like you done in Weed, neither. Lenny looked puzzled.
Like I done in Weed?
Oh, so you forgot that too, did you? Well, I ain't going to remind you, fear you do it again. A light of understanding broke on Lenny's face.
They run us out of Weed, he exploded triumphantly.
Run us out, hell. Said George disgustedly. We run. They was looking for us, but they didn't catch us. Lenny giggled happily.
I didn't forget that, you bet.
George lay back on the sand and crossed his hands under his head, and Lenny imitated him, raising his head to see whether he were doing it right. God, you're a lot of trouble, said George. I could get along so easy and so nice if I didn't have you on my tail. I could live so easy and maybe have a girl. For a moment, Lenny lay quiet, and then he said hopefully, "We gonna work on a ranch, George?" "All right, you got that. But we're gonna sleep here because I got a reason." The day was going fast now. Only the tops of the Gabalon Mountains flamed with the light of the sun that had gone from the valley. A water snake slipped along on the pool, its head held up like a little periscope. The reeds jerked slightly in the current. Far off toward the highway, a man shouted something, and another man shouted back. The sycamore limbs rustled under a little wind that died immediately. "George, why ain't we going on to the ranch and get some supper? They got supper at the ranch." George rolled on his side. "No reason at all for you. I like it here. Tomorrow we're going to go to work. I seen thrashing machines on the way down. That means we'll be bucking grain bags, busting a gut. Tonight I'm going to lay right here and look up. I like it." Lenny got up on his knees and looked down at George. "Ain't we going to have no supper?" "Sure we are. If you gather up some dead willow sticks, I got 3 cans of beans in my bindle. You get a fire ready. I'll give you a match when you get the sticks together, and we'll heat the beans and have supper." Lenny said, "I like beans with ketchup." "Well, we ain't got no ketchup. You go get wood, and don't you fool around. It'll be dark before long." Lenny lumbered to his feet and disappeared in the brush. George lay where he was and whistled softly to himself. There were sounds of splashings down the river in the direction Lenny had taken. George stopped whistling and listened. "Poor bastard," he said softly, and then went on whistling again. In a moment, Lenny came crashing back through the brush. He carried one small willow stick in his hand. George sat up. "All right," he said brusquely. "Give me that mouse." But Lenny made an elaborate pantomime of innocence. "What mouse, George? I ain't got no mouse." George held out his hand. "Come on. Give it to me. You ain't putting nothing over." Lenny hesitated, backed away, looked wildly at the brush line as though he contemplated running for his freedom. George said coldly, "You gonna give me that mouse, or do I have to sock you?"
"Give you what, George?"
"You know goddamn well what. I want that mouse." Lenny reluctantly reached into his pocket. His voice broke a little. "I don't know why I can't keep it. It ain't nobody's mouse. I didn't steal it. I found it lying right beside the road." George's hand remained outstretched imperiously. Slowly, like a terrier who doesn't want to bring a ball to its master, Lenny approached, drew back, approached again. George snapped his fingers sharply, and at the sound, Lenny laid the mouse in his hand. "I wasn't doing nothing bad with it, George. Just stroking it." George stood up and threw the mouse as far as he could into the darkening brush, and then he stepped to the pool and washed his hands. "You crazy fool. Don't you think I could see your feet was wet where you went across the river to get it?" He heard Lenny's whimpering cry and wheeled about. "Blubberin' like a baby. Jesus Christ. Big guy like you." Lenny's lip quivered and tears started in his eyes. "Oh, Lenny." George put his hand on Lenny's shoulder. "I ain't taking it away just for meanness. That mouse ain't fresh, Lenny. And besides, you've broke it petting it. You get another mouse that's fresh, and I'll let you keep it a little while. Lenny sat down on the ground and hung his head dejectedly. I don't know where there is no other mouse. I remember a lady used to give 'em to me, every one she got. But that lady ain't here. George scoffed. Lady, huh? Don't even remember who that lady was. That was your own Aunt Clara. And she stopped giving 'em to you. You always killed 'em. Lenny looked sadly up at him. They was so little, he said apologetically. I'd pet 'em, and pretty soon they bit my fingers and I pinched their heads a little, and then they was dead, because they was so little. I wish we'd get the rabbits pretty soon, George. They ain't so little. To hell with the rabbits. And you ain't to be trusted with no live mice. Your Aunt Clara give you a rubber mouse and you wouldn't have nothing to do with it. It wa'n't no good to pet, said Lenny. The flame of the sunset lifted from the mountaintops and dusk came into the valley and a half-darkness came in among the willows and the sycamores. A big carp rose to the surface of the pool, gulped air, and then sank mysteriously into the dark water again, leaving widening rings on the water. Overhead the leaves whisked again, and little puffs of willow cotton blew down and landed on the pool's surface. "You gonna get that wood?" George demanded. "There's plenty right up against the back of that sycamore, floodwater wood. Now you get it." Lenny went behind the tree and brought out a litter of dried leaves and twigs. He threw them in a heap on the old ash pile and went back for more and more. It was almost night now. A dove's wings whistled over the water. George walked to the fire pile and lighted the dry leaves. The flame cracked up among the twigs and fell to work. George undid his bindle and brought out 3 cans of beans. He stood them about the fire, close in against the blaze, but not quite touching the flame. "There's enough beans for 4 men," George said. Lenny watched him from over the fire. He said patiently, "I like 'em with ketchup." "Well, we ain't got any," George exploded. "Whatever we ain't got, that's what you want. God almighty! If I was alone, I could live so easy. I could go get a job and work and no trouble, no mess at all. And when the end of the month come, I could take my $50 and go into town and get whatever I want. Why, I could stay in a cat house all night. I could eat any place I want, hotel or any place, and order any damn thing I could think of. And I could do all that every damn month. Get a gallon of whiskey or sit in a pool room and play cards or shoot poo." Lenny knelt and looked over the fire at the angry George. And Lenny's face was drawn with terror. "And what do I got?" George went on furiously. "I got you. You can't keep a job and you lose me every job I get. Just keep me shoving all over the country all the time and that ain't the worst. You get in trouble. You do bad things, and I gotta get you out." His voice rose nearly to a shout. "You crazy son of a bitch! You keep me in hot water all the time!" He took on the elaborate manner of little girls when they're mimicking one another. "Just wanted to feel that girl's dress. Just wanted to pet it like it was a mouse. Well, how the hell did she know you just wanted to feel her dress? She jerks back, and you hold on like it was a mouse. She yells, and we gotta hide in an irrigation ditch all day with guys looking for us, and we gotta sneak out in the dark and get out of the country. All the time, something like that. All the time!"
I wished I could put you in a cage with about 1,000,000 mice and let you have fun.
His anger left him suddenly. He looked across the fire at Lenny's anguished face, and then he looked ashamedly at the flames. It was quite dark now, but the fire lighted the trunks of the trees and the curving branches overhead. Lenny crawled slowly and cautiously around the fire until he was close to George. He sat back on his heels. George turned the bean cans so that another side faced the fire. He pretended to be unaware of Lenny so close beside him. George? Very softly. No answer. George? What do you want?
I was only fooling, George. I don't want no ketchup. I wouldn't eat no ketchup if it was right here beside me.
If it was here, you could have some.
But I wouldn't eat none, George. I'd leave it all for you. You could cover your beans with it, and I wouldn't touch none of it.
George still stared morosely at the fire. When I think of the swell time I could have without you, I go nuts. I never get no peace.
Lenny still knelt.
He looked off into the darkness across the river.
George, you want I should go away and leave you alone?
Where the hell could you go?
Well, I could. I could go off in the hills there. Some place I'd find a cave.
Yeah? How'd you eat? You ain't got sense enough to find nothing to eat.
I'd find things, George. I don't need no nice food with ketchup. I'd lay out in the sun and nobody'd hurt me. And if I found a mouse, I could keep it. Nobody'd take it away from me.
George looked quickly and searchingly at him. I've been mean, ain't I?
If you don't want me, I can go off in the hills and find a cave. I can go away any time.
No. Look, I was just fooling, Lenny. Because I want you to stay with me. Trouble with mice is you always kill 'em. He paused. Tell you what I'll do, Lenny. First chance I get, I'll give you a pup. Maybe you wouldn't kill it. That'd be better than mice. And you could pet it harder.
Lenny avoided the bait. He'd sensed his advantage.
If you don't want me, you only just gotta say so, and I'll go off in those hills right there. Right up in those hills and live by myself. And I won't get no mice stole from me.
George said, I want you to stay with me, Lenny. Jesus Christ, somebody'd shoot you for a coyote if you was by yourself. No, you stay with me. Your Aunt Clara wouldn't like you running off by yourself, even if she is dead.
Lenny spoke craftily. Tell me, like you done before.
Tell you what?
About the rabbits.
George snapped.
You ain't gonna put nothing over on me.
Lenny pleaded.
Come on, George. Tell me. Please, George, like you done before.
You get a kick out of that, don't you?
All right. I'll tell you, and then we'll eat our supper.
George's voice became deeper. He repeated his words rhythmically, as though he'd said them many times before.
Guys like us that work on ranches are the loneliest guys in the world. They got no family. They don't belong no place.
They come to a ranch and work up a stake, and then they go into town and blow their stake, and the first thing you know, they're pounding their tail on some other ranch. They ain't got nothing to look ahead to. Lenny was delighted. That's it. That's it. Now, tell how it is with us. George went on. With us, it ain't like that. We got a future. We got somebody to talk to that gives a damn about us. We don't have to sit in no bar room blowing in our jack just because we got no place else to go. If them other guys gets in jail, they can rot for all anybody gives a damn, but not us. Lenny broke in. But not us. And why? Because I got you to look after me, and you got me to look after you, and that's why. He laughed delightedly. Go on now, George. You got it by heart. You can do it yourself. No, you. I forget some of the things. Tell about how it's going to be. Okay. Someday, we're going to get the jack together, and we're going to have a little house and a couple of acres and a cow and some pigs and live off the fat of the land. Then he shouted, and have rabbits. Go on, George, tell about what we're going to have in the garden and about the rabbits in the cages and about the rain in the winter and the stove and how thick the cream is on the milk like you can hardly cut it. Tell about that, George. Why don't you do it yourself? You know all of it. No, you tell it. It ain't the same if I tell it. Go on, George. How I get to tend the rabbits. Well, said George, we'll have a big vegetable patch and a rabbit hutch and chickens. And when it rains in the winter, we'll just say the hell with going to work, and we'll build up a fire in the stove and sit around it and listen to the rain coming down on the roof. Nuts. He took out his pocket knife. I ain't got time for no more. He drove his knife through the top of one of the bean cans, sawed out the top, and passed the can to Lenny. Then he opened a second can. From his side pocket he brought out two spoons and passed one of them to Lenny. They sat by the fire and filled their mouths with beans and chewed mightily. A few beans slipped out of the side of Lenny's mouth. George gestured with his spoon. What you going to say tomorrow when the boss asks you questions? Lenny stopped chewing and swallowed. His face was concentrated.
I ain't going to say a word.
Good boy. That's fine, Lenny. Maybe you're getting better. When we get the couple of acres, I can let you tend the rabbits, all right? Especially if you remember as good as that. Lenny choked with pride.
I can remember, he said.
George motioned with his spoon again. Look, Lenny, I want you to look around here. You can remember this place, can't you? The ranch is about a quarter mile up that way. Just follow the river?
Sure, said Lenny. I can remember this. Didn't I remember about not going to say a word?
Of course you did. Well, look, Lenny, if you just happen to get in trouble like you always done before, I want you to come right here and hide in the brush.
Hide in the brush, said Lenny slowly.
Hide in the brush till I come for you. Can you remember that?
Sure I can, George. Hide in the brush till you come.
But you ain't gonna get in no trouble, because if you do, I won't let you tend the rabbit. He threw his empty bean can off into the brush.
I won't get in no trouble, George. I ain't gonna say a word.
Okay. Bring your bindle over here by the fire. It's gonna be nice sleeping here, looking up in the leaves. Don't build up no more fire. We'll let her die down. They made their beds on the sand, and as the blaze dropped from the fire, the sphere of light grew smaller. The curling branches disappeared, and only a faint glimmer showed where the tree trunks were. From the darkness, Lenny called, "George, you asleep?" "No. What do you want?"
"Let's have different color rabbits, George."
"Sure we will," George said sleepily. "Red and blue and green rabbits, Lenny. Millions of them."
"Furry ones, George. Like I seen in the fair in Sacramento."
"Sure. Furry ones. 'Cause I can just as well go away, George, and live in a cave." "You can just as well go to hell," said George. "Shut up now." The red light dimmed on the coals. Up the hill from the river, a coyote yammered, and a dog answered from the other side of the stream. The sycamore leaves whispered in a little night breeze. The bunkhouse was a long rectangular building. Inside, the walls were whitewashed and the floor unpainted. In three walls, there were small square windows, and in the fourth, a solid door with a wooden latch. Against the walls were eight bunks, five of them made up with blankets and the other three showing their burlap ticking. Over each bunk, there was nailed an apple box with the opening forward so that it made two shelves for the personal belongings of the occupant of the bunk. And these shelves were loaded with little articles, soap and talcum powder, razors, and those Western magazines ranchmen love to read and scoff at and secretly believe. And there were medicines on the shelves and little vials, combs, and from nails on the box sides a few neckties. Near one wall there was a black cast-iron stove, its stovepipe going straight up through the ceiling. In the middle of the room stood a big square table littered with playing cards, and around it were grouped boxes for the players to sit on. At about 10 o'clock in the morning, the sun threw a bright dust-laden bar through one of the side windows, and in and out of the beam flies shot like rushing stars. The wooden latch raised. The door opened, and a tall, stoop-shouldered old man came in. He was dressed in blue jeans, and he carried a big push-broom in his left hand. Behind him came George, and behind George, Lenny.
"The boss was expecting you last night," the old man said. "He was sore as hell when you wasn't here to go out this morning."
He pointed with his right arm, and out of the sleeve came a round, stick-like wrist, but no hand.
"You can have them two beds there," he said,
indicating two bunks near the stove. George stepped over and threw his blankets down on the burlap sack of straw that was a mattress. He looked into his box shelf and then picked a small yellow can from it.
"Say, what the hell's this?"
"I don't know," said the old man.
"Says positively kills lice, roaches, and other scourges. What the hell kind of bed you giving us anyway? We don't want no pants rabbits."
The old swamper lifted his broom and held it between his elbow and his side while he held out his hand for the can. He studied the label carefully.
"Tell you what," he said finally, "last guy that had this bed was a blacksmith. Hell of a nice fella and as clean a guy as you'd want to meet. Used to wash his hands even after he ate."
"Then how come he got graybacks?"
George was working up a slow anger. Lenny put his bindle on the neighboring bunk and sat down. He watched George with open mouth.
"Tell you what,
said the old swamper. This here blacksmith, name of Whitey, was the kind of guy that would put that stuff around even if there wasn't no bugs, just to make sure, see? Tell you what he used to do. At meals, he'd peel his boiled potatoes, and he'd take out every little spot, no matter what kind, before he'd eat it. And if there was a red splotch on an egg, he'd scrape it off. Finally quit about the food. That's the kind of guy he was. Clean. He used to dress up Sundays even when he wasn't going no place. Put on a necktie even. And then set in the bunkhouse. I ain't so sure, said George skeptically. What'd you say he quit for? The old man put the yellow can in his pocket and he rubbed his bristly white whiskers with his knuckles. Why, he just quit, the way a guy will. Says it was the food. Just wanted to move. Didn't give no other reason but the food. Just says, give him my time one night, the way any guy would. George lifted his tick and looked underneath it. He leaned over and inspected the sacking closely. Immediately, Lenny got up and did the same with his bed. Finally, George seemed satisfied. He unrolled his bindle and put things on the shelf, his razor and bar of soap, his comb and bottle of pills, his liniment and leather wristband. Then he made his bed up neatly with blankets. The old man said, I guess the boss will be out here in a minute. He was sure burned when you wasn't here this morning. Come right in when we was eating breakfast and says, where the hell's them new men? And he gave the stable buck hell, too. George patted a wrinkle out of his bed and sat down. Give the stable buck hell? He asked. Sure. You see, the stable buck's a nigger.
Nigger, huh?
Yeah. Nice fella, too. Got a crooked back where a horse kicked him. The boss gives him hell when he's mad, but the stable buck don't give a damn about that. He reads a lot. Got books in his room.
What kind of guy is the boss? George asked.
Well, he's a pretty nice fella. Gets pretty mad sometimes, but he's pretty nice. Tell you what, know what he done Christmas? Bring a gallon of whiskey right in here and says, drink hearty, boys. Christmas comes but once a year.
The hell he did. Whole gallon?
Yes, sir. Jesus, we had fun. They let the nigger come in that night. Little Skinner, name of Smitty, took after the nigger. Done pretty good, too. The guys wouldn't let him use his feet, so the nigger got him. If he could have used his feet, Smitty says he would have killed the nigger. The guy said on account of the nigger's got a crooked back, Smitty can't use his feet. He paused in relish of the memory. After that, the guys went into Soledad and raised hell. I didn't go in there. I ain't got the poop no more.
Lenny was just finishing making his bed. The wooden latch raised again, and the door opened. A little stocky man stood in the open doorway. He wore blue jean trousers, a flannel shirt, a black unbuttoned vest, and a black coat. His thumbs were stuck in his belt on each side of a square steel buckle. On his head was a soiled brown Stetson hat, and he wore high-heeled boots and spurs to prove he wasn't a laboring man. The old swamper looked quickly at him, then shuffled to the door, rubbing his whiskers with his knuckles as he went.
Them guys just come, he said,
and shuffled past the boss and out the door. The boss stepped into the room with the short, quick steps of a fat-legged man.
I wrote Murray and Reddy. I wanted two men this morning. You got your work slips?
George reached into his pocket and produced the slips and handed them to the boss.
It wasn't Murray and Reddy's fault. Says right here on the slip that you was to be here for work this morning.
George looked down at his feet. bus driver gave us a bum steer, he said. We had to walk 10 miles. Says we was here when we wasn't. We couldn't get no rides in the morning. The boss squinted his eyes. Well, I had to send out the grain team short 2 buckers. Won't do any good to go out now until after dinner. He pulled his time book out of his pocket and opened it where a pencil was stuck between the leaves. George scowled meaningfully at Lenny, and Lenny nodded to show that he understood. The boss licked his pencil. What's your name?
George Milton.
And what's yours? George said, his name's Lenny Small. The names were entered in the book. Let's see. This is the 20th. Noon the 20th. He closed the book. Where you boys been working?
Up around Weed, said George.
You too?
To Lenny.
Yeah, him too, said George. The boss pointed a playful finger at Lenny. He ain't much of a talker, is he?
No, he ain't. But he's sure a hell of a good worker. Strong as a bull.
Lenny smiled to himself.
Strong as a bull, he repeated.
George scowled at him, and Lenny dropped his head in shame at having forgotten. The boss said suddenly, Listen, Small. Lenny raised his head. What can you do? In a panic, Lenny looked at George for help. He can do anything you tell him, said George. He's a good skinner. He can wrestle grain bags, drive a cultivator. He can do anything, just give him a try. The boss turned on George. Then why don't you let him answer? What are you trying to put over? George broke in loudly. Oh, I ain't saying he's bright. He ain't. But I say he's a goddamn good worker. He can put up a 400-pound bale. The boss deliberately put the little book in his pocket. He hooked his thumbs in his belt and squinted one eye nearly closed. Say, what you selling?
Huh?
I said, what stake you got in this guy? You taking his pay away from him?
No, of course I ain't.
Why you think I'm selling him out? Well, I never seen one guy take so much trouble for another guy. I just like to know what your interest is.
George said, He's my cousin. I told his old lady I'd take care of him. He got kicked in the head by a horse when he was a kid. He's all right, just ain't bright. But he can do anything you tell him.
The boss turned half away. Well, God knows he don't need any brains to buck barley bags. But don't you try to put nothing over, Milton. I got my eye on you. Why'd you quit and weed?
Job was done, said George promptly.
What kind of job?
We was digging a cesspool.
All right. But don't try to put nothing over, 'cause you can't get away with nothing. I seen wise guys before. Go on out with the grain teams after dinner. They're picking up barley at the threshing machine. Go out with Slim's team.
Slim?
Yeah. Big, tall skinner. You'll see him at dinner.
He turned abruptly and went to the door, but before he went out, he turned and looked for a long moment at the two men. When the sound of his footsteps had died away, George turned on Lenny.
So you wasn't going to say a word. You was going to leave your big flapper shut and leave me do the talking. Damn near lost us the job.
Lenny stared hopelessly at his hands.
I forgot, George.
Yeah, you forgot. You always forget, and I gotta talk you out of it. He sat down heavily on the bunk.
Now he's got his eye on us. Now we got to be careful and not make no slips. You keep your big flapper shut after this. He fell morosely silent. George, what you want now?
I wasn't kicked in the head with no horse, was I, George?
Be a damn good thing if you was, George said viciously. Save everybody a hell of a lot of trouble.
You said I was your cousin, George.
Well, that was a lie, and I'm damn glad it was. If I was a relative of yours, I'd shoot myself. He stopped suddenly, stepped to the open front door and peered out. Say, what the hell you doing, listening? The old man came slowly into the room. He had his broom in his hand, and at his heels there walked a drag-footed sheepdog, gray of muzzle, and with pale, blind old eyes. The dog struggled lamely to the side of the room and lay down, grunting softly to himself and licking his grizzled, moth-eaten coat. The swamper watched him until he was settled.
I wasn't listening. I was just standing in the shade a minute, scratching my dog. I just now finished swamping out the wash house.
You was poking your big ears into our business, George said. I don't like nobody to get nosy. The old man looked uneasily from George to Lenny and then back.
I just come there, he said. I didn't hear nothing you guys was saying. I ain't interested in nothing you was saying. A guy on a ranch don't never listen, nor he don't ask no questions.
Damn right he don't, said George, slightly mollified. Not if he wants to stay working long. But he was reassured by the swamper's defense. Come on in and sit down a minute, he said. That's a hell of an old dog.
Yeah, I had him ever since he was a pup. God, he was a good sheepdog when he was younger.
He stood his broom against the wall, and he rubbed his white bristled cheek with his knuckles.
How'd you like the boss?
He asked. Pretty good. Seemed all right.
He's a nice fella, the swamper agreed. You gotta take him right.
At that moment, a young man came into the bunkhouse, a thin young man with a brown face, with brown eyes and a head of tightly curled hair. He wore a work glove on his left hand, and like the boss, he wore high-heeled boots.
Seen my old man? He asked.
The swamper said,
he was here just a minute ago, Curly. Went over to the cookhouse, I think.
I'll try to catch him, said Curly. His eyes passed over the new man, and he stopped. He glanced coldly at George, and then at Lenny. His arms gradually bent at the elbows, and his hands closed into fists. He stiffened and went into a slight crouch. His glance was at once calculating and pugnacious. Lenny squirmed under the look and shifted his feet nervously. Curly stepped gingerly close to him.
You the new guys the old man was waiting for?
We just come in, said George.
Let the big guy talk.
Lenny twisted with embarrassment. George said, suppose he don't want to talk. Curly lashed his body around.
By Christ, he's got to talk when he's spoken to. What the hell you getting into it for?
We travel together, said George coldly.
Oh, so it's that way.
George was tense and motionless.
Yeah,
it's that way. Lenny was looking helplessly to George for instruction.
And you won't let the big guy talk, is that it?
He can talk if he wants to tell you anything. He nodded slightly to Lenny.
We just come in, said Lenny softly.
Curly stared levelly at him.
Well, next time you answer when you spoke to.
He turned toward the door and walked out, and his elbows were still bent out a little. George watched him out, and then he turned back to the swamper. Say, what the hell's he got on his shoulder? Lenny didn't do nothing to him. The old man looked cautiously at the door to make sure no one was listening.
That's the boss's son, he said quietly. Curly's pretty handy. He done quite a bit in the ring. He's a lightweight, and he's handy.
Well, let him be handy, said George. He don't have to take after Lenny. Lenny didn't do nothing to him. What's he got against Lenny?
The swamper considered. Well, tell you what, Curly's like a lot of little guys. He hates big guys. He's all the time picking scraps with big guys. Kind of like he's mad at him because he ain't a big guy. You seen little guys like that, ain't you? Always scrappy?
Sure, said George. I seen plenty tough little guys. But this Curly better not make no mistakes about Lenny. Lenny ain't handy. But this Curly punk is going to get hurt if he messes around with Lenny.
Well, Curly's pretty handy, the swamper said skeptically. Never did seem right to me. Suppose Curly jumps a big guy and licks him. Everybody says what a game guy Curly is. And suppose he does the same thing and gets licked. Then everybody says the big guy ought to pick somebody his own size, and maybe they gang up on the big guy. Never did seem right to me. Seems like Curly ain't giving nobody a chance.
George was watching the door. He said ominously, Well, he better watch out for Lenny. Lenny ain't no fighter, but Lenny's strong and quick, and Lenny don't know no rules.
He walked to the square table and sat down on one of the boxes. He gathered some of the cards together and shuffled them. The old man sat down on another box. Don't tell Curly I said none of this. He'd slew me. He just don't give a damn. Won't ever get canned, 'cause his old man's a boss.
George cut the cards and began turning them over, looking at each one and throwing it down on a pile. He said, This guy Curly sounds like a son of a bitch to me. I don't like mean little guys.
Seems to me like he's worse lately, said the swamper. He got married a couple of weeks ago. Wife lives over in the boss's house. Seems like Curly is cockier than ever since he got married.
George grunted. Maybe he's showing off for his wife. The swamper warmed to his gossip.
You seen that glove on his left hand?
Yeah, I seen it.
Well, that glove's full of Vaseline.
Vaseline? What the hell for?
Well, I'll tell you what. Curly says he's keeping that hand soft for his wife.
George studied the cards absorbedly. That's a dirty thing to tell around, he said. The old man was reassured. He'd drawn a derogatory statement from George. He felt safe now, and he spoke more confidently.
Wait till you see Curly's wife.
George cut the cards again and put out a solitaire lay, slowly and deliberately.
Purdy?
He asked casually.
Yeah, Purdy. But,
George studied his cards.
But what? Well, she got the eye.
Yeah?
Married 2 weeks and got the eye? Maybe that's why Curly's pants is full of ants. I seen her give Slim the eye. Slim's a jerkline skinner, hell of a nice feller. Slim don't need to wear no high-heeled boots on a grain team. I seen her give Slim the eye. Curly never seen it, and I seen her give Carlson the eye.
George pretended a lack of interest. Looks like we was going to have fun. The swamper stood up from his box.
Know what I think?
George didn't answer.
Well, I think Curly's married a tart.
He ain't the first, said George. There's plenty done that.
This ends Disc 1.